Turn to Revelation again. I want to make two announcements. I saved it for right now. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 10 and 11. I've preached a lot out here. Actually, 9 and 10. I want to show you these verses and then give you kind of an expository of this passage of Scripture. Wednesday night, this Wednesday night. Now, I preached last Wednesday on the sons of Issachar that understood the times or discerned the times. We're in the last day. Amen. Things are happening right now so rapidly, and a lot of people don't understand. Listen, what's happening in the Middle East is not about Syria. It's about Israel. And it's about the bear from the north that snubbing his nose up to the United States of America. And I'm telling it like it is. Some people that's politically correct don't like that kind of preaching. And that bear's none other than Russia and Moscow, found in Ezekiel 38 and 39. But this Wednesday, this good time you start Wednesday night prayer meeting. Make sure you're here. And I want to make one more announcement. How many of you got kids that are not in Awana yet? Yeah, or maybe they've never been. And Awana is from 2 years old all the way through high school. 9 through 12 meets on, I believe, Tuesday night at 6:30. And then grades 2 or ages 2 through the 8th grade meets on Wednesday night. How many of you got kids in that age bracket that are not in Awana right now and you really need to get them in a place where they can be taught? Raise your hand if you've got anybody in that age bracket. Don't lie to me. I'm looking at you. All right, then why not have them here this Wednesday night? Amen? And we want to, we thank God for what happened this past Wednesday night. One saved, had 223 in Awana Wednesday night, and we praise God for it. Let's look at the passage. The Bible said, "And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser," this is the verse I'll read. I could read verse 9 too, but I'm going to read this one. This is what I want to hit. "For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night." Now, I'll give you the title of the sermon probably about two-thirds through, okay? That's a little unusual for me, but I'm all two-thirds through. And I want you to really stay tuned to me today because I'm going to relate to everybody in this room. Now, I want you to do a study with me. I have a lot of people that come to me and say, "Revelation is the hardest book I ever read." Well, it's not. Actually, Revelation is not difficult at all. I have more problem with Hebrews and I have more problem with Daniel than I do Revelation. And if you understand Daniel, you'll start understanding Revelation better. And you know, God, I tell you what God done. God gave you an outline of Revelation. Ain't no reason everybody in this room ought not to know about the book of Revelation if you're saved. Because God gave you an outline. You said, "Well, I ain't never seen no outline." Then you ain't never read it right. John was on the Isle of Patmos on the Lord's Day. By the way, I'm glad I know what the Lord's Day is. Sunday. Amen. This is not the Sabbath. Hello. False religions meet on the Sabbath. The church, the bride, the body meets on the Lord's Day. Resurrection Day. The day you bring your tithes to the store, which is the church. This is the day. Well, glory. John was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day, and he heard a voice. And by the way, when he heard the voice, he turned around. This is chapter 1. And he saw Jesus. I want y'all to hear me. If you hear the voice of God, every time you hear it, look, it's Jesus. It's not Muhammad. It's not Buddha. It's not Scientology. It's not some goofed up Eastern religion. It's not some conglomeration of Judaism and Christianity. It's Jesus. He is the voice. He is the word. He is God's communication to you. Amen. And then that voice said this, John, write the things which are and thou hast seen. That's chapter 1. He saw Jesus. Y'all said, I want to know what he looks like when he comes. Read chapter 1. Eyes as a flame of fire. Feet as fine brass. Hair white as wool. That's Jesus. And by the way, all those things talk about his character. Then he said, John, not only write the things which thou hast seen, but write the things which are, 2 and 3, chapter 2 and 3. That is the seven churches of Asia. By the way, there were more than seven in Asia, but God decreed these seven was written to by the writer John. You said, why? Because they were seven local churches. By the way, God still got a message for the local church. And that is, Jesus is alive. I'm he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and hell. Boy, I'm starting to sense something. The things that are the seven churches. By the way, when you study about the seven churches were seven literal churches. The seven churches, you can find parts of it in every church now. Predominantly, we're living in the Laodicean church. But also, the seven churches had a prophetic meaning. I think we're living right in an overlap of the sixth and the seventh. The one that he gave an open door and shall overcome and not go through tribulation. Well, that's us. The church of the living God will not make one day of the tribulation. We're going out before there's a war with Russia and everything's getting there right now. We go out before that because that's in the middle of the tribulation. I'm about to shout. I believe we ought to be looking up because if all that's happening before our eyes, how close is it? Amen. I'm not going to set a date. That's ignorance. Then write the things that shall be hereafter. Chapter 4 through chapter 22. That's the plan of our Lord. Chapter 1, the person of our Lord. Chapter 2 and 3, the church, the possessions of our Lord. Chapter 4 through 22, the plan of our Lord. I'm glad he got a plan. Then now I want you to turn over to Revelation 12 and I'll show you three things by way of introduction. And on the third one, I'll finish and give you the title. First of all, John saw a woman. Look at her in verse 1, would you? And stay with me because it's going to get good here in about 15 minutes. It's good already, but it's going to get better. And there appeared a great woman, a wonder in heaven, a woman. Who in the world is this? A woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet and upon her head a crown with 12 stars. Listen here, verse 2. And she being with child cried, travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. Who in the world is the woman? You found out who the woman is, business is going to start picking up. Here's what we know about her. We know she has 12 stars. We know in verse 4 she's suffering. We know she has a man child who's going to rule all nations. Well, who's that? Jesus said, I came unto my own. And my own received me not, but to many as received me gave him power to become the sons of God. Israel right now is in a blinded state. They're blinded, but God's not done with Israel. They're blind right now. As a whole, as a nation, they're blind, but there's some Jews getting saved. Leon Brusky, raise your hand. And others that are at Judy, raise your hand. God's still saving Jewish people, but not through their way, but through the gospel. Amen. That man child is Jesus. Root all the nations. caught up into heaven. Who else is it? Wasn't Muhammad, he's in a grave somewhere. Wasn't Buddha, he's in a pot belly somewhere. Some Christians now, because they are compromisers, are trying to blend Judaism and Christianity. Well, he told them in Galatians, that wasn't right. And Paul said, if you preach another gospel, you are cursed. And they're trying to blend them in as a compromise. There's no compromise. There's one church, one body, one bride, one building, and we come into that church because we got saved, we got scripturally baptized, and we're a part of that church. Somebody shout. Whew. Number two, we see in verse 1 and also verse 3, not only do I see a woman, I see a wonder. Look what it says. A wonder in heaven. First of all, the woman. She was a wonder. By the way, the greatest wonder in the world is that Jesus Christ came born of a virgin, lived 33 and a half years, died on an old rugged cross. On the third day, rose again. Somebody help me preach right there. And is on the right hand of God the Father right now. Well, hallelujah. And we see another wonder. Now, a lot of people get goofed up here. And I'm going to straighten you up today. Because if you interpret this wrong, you're completely off the charts. And most people do. Me and Jared's had a few talks about this passage. But I think he's starting to get on the wagon. He even told me more evidence that he ought to be on the wagon. He's on the wagon now, aren't you? Yeah. These young guys, they never want to say, you're right. They just kind of mosey on along. But I am right. Verse 3, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon, having seven heads. By the way, you want to know who those seven heads is? Just go through history. And I'll just give you a few of them. Babylon. The Medes and Persians. The Greeks under Alexander the Great. The Romans. And two others. But the seventh king is the Antichrist. The kingdom that is to come. Whew. That's the wonder. And the dragon himself. By the way, friends, we're living right here. Somebody look at me right now. We're living right there during that time. We're getting ready for the rapture and the Antichrist be revealed. And it's so close. It is so close. And by the way, I'm going to make a statement. I'll probably get in trouble, but I've been in trouble before. I'm going to make this statement. A lot of people are disappointed in the course of America right now. I being one of them. We have absolutely no respect nationally and far as the world. Absolutely zero. Nobody would have ever snubbed a president of the United States before now. You're right. They have no respect for our government, no respect for our leaders. Am I preaching? Right. And by the way, I'm losing a lot of respect myself. There's an outright war going on between government and the people. Am I preaching? They are secular, and they don't want to have anything to do with a blood-bought church. They don't care about running around with a harlot church. They do not care about the ecumenical movement. They do not care about that, but they do care when an old red-faced old man gets up and said, Jesus is the only way to heaven. They do care when I said the church is still alive. And though the outlook is dark, the outlook is bright. They don't like that. Verse 6 and 7, I'll give you the third thing, and then the text or the title. Look at it with me. Are you there? And the woman fled into the wilderness where she hath a place prepared. This was right in the middle of the tribulation. And they should feed her there 1,260 days, or 3.5 years. And there was a war in heaven. What was going on in the earth? The devil was going. So not only do we have a woman, a wonder, and a war. And there was a war in heaven. Now, here's where I want to teach you something. You see over in verse 3 and 4, the devil and his angels were cast down. But see, some people think verse 6 is the same thing. Ladies and gentlemen, it is not the same. This is in right after the judgment seat of Christ. By the way, read the book of Job. Said the sons of God came before the throne. By the way, at that time they were angels. Now we're sons of God by faith. And the devil came with them. Right now he appears before the throne every day, every moment, to accuse you and say, you're not a very good Christian. You're lost and on your way to hell. You're not a very good person. And he's constantly accusing us. We're not very good pastors. He's constantly accusing us. That's what he's doing right now. But I want you to notice what happens. Boy, I'm about to shout and somebody ought to also. In verse 8, look at it. And prevailed not. He didn't win. And the great dragon was cast out. The old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth and his angels were cast out with him. They were accusing the brethren. And for the last time, Satan had any availability to heaven. At the judgment seat of Christ, I can see him there with us Christians saying, oh, I remember them in Tate Valley Baptist Church. I remember their attitude there and start throwing slurs at you. But they're going to be one get up and say, hold it. Hold it. Amen. Hold it! They overcome you by the blood of the Lamb. Amen. They overcame you by the word of their testimony. And they love not their lives until death. Here's what I want to preach on tonight, or this morning. You said you done preached 20 minutes and you ain't give us a title? It's time. It's time to show Satan the door. Amen. Somebody help me there. How many of you agree? It's time to show the devil the door. Amen. He's been occupying us too long. He's been beating on us too long. And you said, but I don't know how to show him the door. I'm getting there. See, I have a confidence here. They overcame him by the blood. I have a court by the word of their testimony. And then they loved not their lives till death. Now, I want to tell you who should say, Satan, hit the road. Show him the door. Three people in three groups, and I'm done. Sinner man, sinner woman, sinner boy and girl. You need to tell Satan where the door is. You said, but I don't know how to overcome. I don't know what to do. Can I tell you what to do? Trust the blood. Amen. They overcame him by the blood. When he starts accusing us, guess what? I say to him, paid, 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 paid. You said, what do you mean? My sins are gone. They've been paid for. But here, sinner, you're here lost today. We're getting ready for the rapture, and I'm looking you right in your eyeball and telling you, you better say you're getting out of my life. You've done ruined my life enough. You done messed my marriage up. You messed my workplace up. You messed my family up. I am not going to allow you to take me to hell also. Today, I'm trusting the blood. Today, I'm going to confess Jesus Christ. Today, I'm saying, Satan, get out of my life. You got to do it today. because the Lord might come today. Or you may die today. Sinner, can I ask you a question? What good has he been to you? Just look at your life, sinner, and tell me what good he's been to you. I'll tell you what he's done. He's led you to a reckless lifestyle. I'll tell you what he's done. If you're married, he's messed up your marriage most of the time. I'll tell you what he's done. He's kept you from the biggest and greatest gift you ever received, Jesus. It's time for you today, you're sensing the Holy Ghost work on you. You need to say, I'm going to claim the blood. I'm going to receive the blood atonement. I'm getting him out of my life. I'm tired of living this kind of miserable life. I am tired of him controlling me constantly. Tell him to get out. Come to the altar and receive Jesus. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'll guarantee you receive him. He's got to get out. He comes in and the devil goes out. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things has become new. I tell you, somebody else needs to show him the door. The saints, the children of God. He said, who are the saints? Me. You said, well, you haven't went through the sainthood. It takes about 400 years, don't it? And I'll be honest with you. He convicted me and came where I was, and I said yes. And by the way, right then I was declared a saint. Right then I was declared righteous. Somebody shout glory. Amen. But I want to tell you, you might be discouraged. At people, at things, at happenings. But you're discouraged at the wrong person. It's the devil. He's behind it all. Instead of you griping and grumbling, why don't you say, get out. Get out. I'm not taking it anymore. You're not messing with my mind anymore. He's the one that causes disappointments. By the way, a lot of people say, well, I'm not where I used to be because I'm disappointed in such and such a person. I'm going to be honest with you. I ain't blaming nobody today because the devil's the person. I'll be honest with you. I'm more disappointed with me than I am anybody else, or because I've let the devil handle me too many times. Am I preaching? Don't say I'm the only one in this church that's let the devil handle you. Every once in a while, he gets up in my mouth and I say something I shouldn't. Every once in a while, he gets in my heart and I don't forgive somebody I should. And then I get disappointed. And by the way, the word disappointed is real easy. It's not by your appointment, not when you think things ought to happen. Then depresses you. You know, a lot of people make fun of people that are depressed. I'll give you a little pastoral counsel. You might not want to do that because you may hit it yourself and you may fall into that trap. And I'm going to tell you the only thing you can do when you get depressed, tell him to get out. Because most of the time he's working on your mind and oppressing your mind. Am I preaching? You're a saint of God. You're an heir of God. You've got the Holy Spirit. He'll get out if you let Christ dwell within. Then lastly, the sanctuary worshipers need to tell him to get out. That's the church. You say, what do you mean? Don't give time to being a troublemaker. I ain't got time for that. Listen, we got to get together. Hey, church, we need on the same page. No time to let him cause you to be a troublemaker. Tell him to get out. No time to you be a tailbearer. By the way, it'd be good for you to quit running around negative people. And it'd be good, first time somebody negative says something about the church, as great as our church is going, or about the pastor or the deacons or the leaders, you need to say, shut your mouth, I ain't listening to you anymore. And get out of my way and say, devil, you caused them to come, get out. I'll tell you what, if every church member would practice this, in every church that I'm preaching to right now, when some troublemaker comes and talebearer comes wanting to tell you some lie and cause the preacher or the church some trouble or cause one of your brother and sister some trouble, you need to tell them, stop your mouth. I ain't listening to them. Hey, there's too many people give credence to people that do that, and because you want to live peaceably with them. But it's sometimes it's good to just look them in the face and say, shut up. Get out. And the one that calls them to come, tell him to get out. Am I preaching? I told y'all it was going to get better. You said, but if I don't give time to troublemakers and I don't give time to tell bearers, well, who do I give my time to? Give time to some prayer. Church, it was proven last March and April. When we got on our knees for 2 or 3 months and came out on Monday night, what prayer could do? Had the greatest jubilee we've ever had. The power of God fell down. And won't you give some time to prayer? God can work everything out. Also, give some time to preaching. That's what I've been doing for the last 25 minutes. And you know some of us hit you. Why don't you respond to it instead of acting like some reject? Am I preaching? Probably not real politically correct, but it's about the best I got today. Give time to provisions. I got a God who can provide for every need this church has. Every need. We're doing great things right now in soul winning and missions. He'll supply that need. But also, God, I got a God who can take us further than we've ever went before. If we get some people of faith that will give time to say, God, I believe you'll do it. But here's what we do. Satan, right here in our minds, that is impossible. And we contradict everything God ever said. With me, all things are possible. I think we need to show Satan the door. And you know, we're starting a new program tonight. And you know, people can say, well, it ain't going to work because it's different. Well, there was a day when they started your program and it worked. And there was a day when God started something else and it worked. If God's in it, and I believe he is, got a young man with a vision, want to reach every kid he can with the gospel. Is that wrong? Every bus kid whose parents don't want them, every child that's unloved, if they're going to have loving arms out for them, and it'll be safe, and they're going to get kids home at 11 o'clock at night, 10:30 at night, we're going to have a place where they feel the love of God. You say it's different. So what? I say, show Satan the door. I'm almost done. We need to give time to the people of God. I want to be honest with you. I'm going to say it like it is. I don't have a lot of patience for people that hinder me from loving the church and helping the church and throwing up some situation every day of my life. And I allowed, let the devil come in and bang. The O'Brien girl sings a song, People Need the Lord. And then we need to give God time to God's priorities. What is his priority? I know what his priority is, the church and souls. God has opened so many doors right now. This man's going to have a training session he's going to tell you about tonight. On the 18th of September, October. And it's going to train you on how to go into the high schools and the junior highs and do the prison prevention, Do y'all not understand this? We have a lot of access to the public schools that we don't even know about. Those kids can do what they want as far as worship. And we can help them. Shouldn't that be a priority? Shouldn't the missionaries that we support across the world be a priority? Shouldn't the unity of this church be a priority? Shouldn't the people that are hurting in our church, financially, physically, emotionally, shouldn't they be a priority? We need to save Satan. Hit the road. Amen. Bow your head.